Okay, I think it's time to start. So welcome everybody to this presentation where we're gonna talk that whether OpenStack will be everywhere in 5G networks. My name is Juha Oravainen.
Okay, my name is Tapio Talengren. And we work in the mobile networks division of Nokia. And in Juha's team, what we have been doing is we've been putting different kind of radio applications on top of different kind of OpenStack deployments. We've been using commercial OpenStack deployments and then this open source OPNFV-based deployments and running radio applications on top of that and seeing what the issues are and how they behave and so forth. So.
Okay, and before we go any further, so can you, Tapio, also tell us from where the title of this presentation came from?
Yeah, sure. So I was giving an interview and then I was asked about 5G and OpenStack, and I was asking, you know, where do you see that the OpenStack is going to be in the 5G networks? And then I was thinking, okay, it's going to be in the core network, and then it's going to be in the radio network. So I answered, it's going to be everywhere. So what else is there? There's radio networks, there's core network, and if you have OpenStack, then it's everywhere.
Okay. Okay. So today's agenda is such that at the beginning of this presentation, I'm gonna talk what is going on in 5G, what is happening in the 5G standards, and what are the 5G requirements. Then, naturally, 5G brings more capacity and enables new use cases, and I have some examples from these use cases in this presentation. And then your part.
Yeah, and then I'm going to talk about what all of this has to do with OpenStack and other open source components, and then we have the summary.
Okay. Yeah. So, let's start from this, that what is going on in 5G area at the moment. First, the 5G specifications, so the schedule is such that in 3GPP standardization organization, the full specifications will be ready in coming year. And this then naturally means that the networks will be up and running around 2019-2020. And before that, there are a lot of trials, live use cases, and I think that the first big event where we really will see that what 5G will bring to us is this next winter's Korean Winter Olympics. At least I'm eagerly waiting to see that what kind of fancy features and functionalities we will see in these Olympics. But because the standards are not yet ready, it means that these trials will be based on pre-standards, like you see from this timeline, so that the 5G study items were completed earlier this year. This layer 1, layer 2 freeze will happen at the end of this year. And then on next year, this standalone higher layers and new core will be defined. And then after that, there are all kind of enhancements. And if you wonder what this non-standalone and standalone means, so standalone is really 5G standalone, but this non-standalone means that 5G works with LTE as the anchor in dual connectivity with 5G. And in this slide, you can see that there are different kind of options for this 5G architecture options. You can see that there are options 3 and 7 and 4, 2 and 6. And this option 3 family, which is for non-standalone, is the focus area until the end of this year. And here you can see that 5G works with LTE as the anchor in dual connectivity with 5G. So in the upper right-hand corner, you can see that there is 5G core network. There is this evolved packet core, long-term evaluating radio networks as well as 5G networks, radio network. So there is 5G part and this 4G part. And then this option 2, which is for this standalone 5G, it has the best effort until the end of this year, and then afterwards it has priority until September 2018. 2018. And if somebody thinks that 5G is just a new radio technique and new frequencies, this is just a reference picture so that you can see that there is happening also a lot in core network side. So there you can see that this 5G user equipment and this 5G radio access network, it is connected to this AMF, which means this access and mobility management function, and it's a part of this 5G control plane part. And then on the lower part of this picture, you can see this UPF, which is this user plane function. So the control plane and the user plane functions are separated there. And in the core, there are naturally also some other parts than this pure 5G core. For example, IMS is visible in this picture. So IMS is IP multimedia subsystem. So the main point in this slide is that 5G is not just a new radio, but a lot of new things are also happening in core network side. And the main points in 5G are maybe the capacity and the bandwidth. So 5G is the new generation of radio systems and the whole new network architecture, which then can deliver extreme broadband, ultra robust, low latencies, and massive networking. So there you can see these 5G devices, which can consume huge amount of data. There is also new smart factories, which can generate maybe some petabytes per day. So then it means that in 5G networks, there will be thousands of times more traffic than in current networks, and 5G must be able to provide this unlimited experience. And it must be able to provide these hundreds of megabits whenever needed, and even more than 10 gigabits peak data rates. And at the same time, there are also coming these billions of sensors, which will be connected to these networks. And it can mean that there, in some ultimate case, there can be maybe even a million devices per square kilometer. And so there will be also this massive machine communication, and 5G must be able to provide this connectivity basically for everything. And if you then think about these autonomous cars and healthcare, so there are some fancy use cases for those also. So then these 5G networks must be also very reliable. And whatever happens in those networks, 5G network must react instantly. And also there is this latency. So in for example, in radio side, we are talking about 1 millisecond latency. So whatever happens in these networks, everything must happen really fast. And if the radio latency is 1 millisecond, so then it of course means that this latency can't happen in any other parts of this network. So for example, if you're talking about OpenV switch or OpenStack or whatever, so everything must happen very fast. So the basic requirements in 5G are capacity, connectivity, reliability, and latency. And if you talk about this capacity and amount of traffic, so in the upper right-hand corner, you can see what is the situation nowadays in this mobile data usage per mobile broadband subscription. So per month, you can see that how much data is generated per month per subscription. Maybe you can see your own country there. And then on the left-hand side, you can see these OGLA speed tests, which were executed in August. So in those countries where there are these highest mobile data usages, those networks, they are delivering about 30 megabits per second. And then on the other hand, the countries with the fastest networks tend to have low or moderate data usage per SIM. So like we have noticed, so this data or the amount of data traffic is increasing very, very fast nowadays, and in, especially in these networks where when there are those fast speeds, something must be done so that these networks must, or that they can guarantee the high data rates even now before 5G is coming, and especially then when 5G is up and running. And another 5G requirement was this latency. So in the left-hand side, you can see that how the situation has been evolved. So in the very left, there is 3G networks, then is 4G and 5G. So in 3G, the latency was about 20 milliseconds. In 4G, it's about 10 milliseconds. And in 5G, we are talking about this one millisecond. So this latency is one very strict requirement in 5G networks. And there you can see how these networks are now evolving in these days. So in today's networks, there are typically tens of thousands of these base stations and quite few core network elements. So currently, radio is distributed and core is centralized. But the target is that this radio processing as well as this core processing, those will be moved to this edge cloud. And so then it means that radio will be more centralized and core will be more distributed. And this way we can gain faster scalability and lower latencies. So typically these core networks have been in these centralized data centers and the lower part of the slide you can see that how things starts to look nowadays. So this, for example, this operations support system, it can be in centralized data centers or in distributed data centers. And core is also moving towards these distributed data centers as well as these radio controllers. But what is now maybe the latest thing is that the radio part is also moving to these distributed data centers. Of course, there are some antennas and things like that, which won't be in the cloud. But this is how it will look like in the very near future and also in nowadays. This is partly the situation. Then I have some examples of these 5G use cases. So there are a lot of these use cases, but I will go through some of them. So here you can see that, for example, how this edge cloud might look like. So I have mentioned this edge cloud already a couple of times in this presentation, but some of you might still wonder what this edge cloud is all about and where it actually is. This picture illustrates how it might look like. And of course, it depends case by case, but this edge cloud can be also in quite inconvenient places. And this must be taken into account in, for example, in these maintenance cases and lifecycle management. So it's not very, very handy if these people need to climb this kind of towers every time when some maintenance activity needs to be done. And here I have a couple of other pictures. So what you see here, and if you think that this is some old mobile phone, then you're wrong. Because what is in this backpack is that it's a whole core network is in that backpack. So this is already available nowadays, okay, not in 5G or but in 3G and 4G, that already works, and this is very handy when there is, for example, some catastrophe in some part of the world, and if some earthquake happens and the whole network goes down, so then the rescue people can take this core network put it into the backpack and take it with them. And this radio network we can provide to those certain areas with those drones. So maybe this is, okay, it's maybe not a distributed cloud, but anyway, you might somehow think about this. And then one use case, which is one of the first use cases in 5G, is that this 5G to the home, this allows fast deployment of enhanced broadband to areas where conventional fiber to the home is difficult or expensive to deploy. So there you can see the core network and the radio network. And with these 5G antennas, we can provide these fiber speeds without cables to the homes. And this enables that low latency multiplayer virtual reality gaming and this high throughput and services like that. And one other use case is this industry. So robots and manufacturing stations, pallets of components, testing stations, all these move around in the factories. And 5G enables manufacturers to cut the wires, opening up flexibility in the production line. So here you can see in the same picture, private cloud and public cloud. So in the upper part of this picture, there is this private cloud, so there are something is done in that factory, and there are those sensors, and then there is this edge cloud, and it's all inside the factory, so that the commercial sensitive data is kept within the factory. But at the same time, we can also have this public cloud there for these non-business critical public applications. So there can be, for example, some video streaming from the factory. So this is one possibility what 5G will bring to us. And then, okay, there are a lot of these use cases. So this is the last one. So 5G is also very good for these healthcare cases. So 5G enables this remote care and remote surgery. So it can improve quality of life, and like especially for example in Finland, so we are getting these older people more and more all the time. So this remote care meets this aging population very, very nicely. Okay, so I went through some of these use cases, especially in this dedicated use case side, so this home, healthcare, and industry cases. There are of course lot of other use cases which will happen in the 5G, and of course we even don't know all of them yet. So 5G can provide, for example, this truck platooning, so that there is only one driver in one truck and the other ones are following, and in public transportation, there can be these infotainment services, and of course in the density areas there are a lot of these different kind of use cases. But this was the beginning of our presentation, and now can you, Tapio, tell what this all means from OpenStack and all in all from open source software and hardware point of view?
Yeah, this is OpenStack Summit, so we should say something about OpenStack. So. Okay, so
exactly.
Next topic is about OpenStack and other open source components and how they fit and what those have to do with the 5G. So what we have is that basically we have the standards organizations, and then, so this is like the big picture about how we build these network elements. We have the standards organizations come up with the standards and define what the 5G is going to look like. Then we have this hardware software reference architectures projects which are working on that, such as the Open Compute project, which is defining hardware architecture. And then we have the different open source projects, and then we, of course, have the industry ecosystem. And so, Juha, you have pretty long experience in telco area. This is not how things used to look like, right? When you were working with the MSC server.
Yes, I still somehow remember those times when everything was first specified, and then after that we did everything all by ourselves. So we have our proprietary hardware and our own operating system and application software, and all things were done all by ourselves. But since that, things have changed a little bit.
Yeah, so these days, of course, the way we built the VNFs or the networks is that we take a lot of different open source components and then build our own applications on top of that. And for that reason, since a lot of the work is about sort of integrating all of these different open source projects, then you have these kind of also have open source projects which are focused on integration and testing the integrated projects. And one nice example is this OpenFV cross-domain CI project, which is taking the OpenStack, OpenDaylight, FIDO, ONAP builds and sort of putting all of them together and testing them together and seeing if they work and sort of being able to flag if there's something that is failing. There's a presentation about that on Wednesday by Fatih if you're interested in this topic a little bit more. So just to show how these different open source projects, how OpenStack fits into this 5G architecture, I took this picture from Juha, and I think it's a little bit complicated, at least for me, so I simplified it a little bit. So I left out all the definitions. And so basically the UE, user equipment, that's a phone typically. So I have this person on the left-hand side who is speaking on the phone. And the data network on the right-hand side corner, that's typically the internet. So this is like supposed to show that a person is connected to the internet and maybe making a Skype or WhatsApp call or something like that. And then I also left out these elements which are not 5G. So basically, from this picture, you can sort of identify the control plane and the user plane. So in the control plane elements, we have currently, at least, we're using virtualization. We have the Open Compute project defining the hardware architecture. We have Linux. OpenStack, of course, is the basis for running it. And then the hardware looks a little bit like this. It's typically like a data center. And here, in this picture thing, you have the Open Compute hardware running the control plane. And then on the user plane, which is on the bottom of the picture, you have the radio access network and the user plane control elements. And there you have the same elements. It's still running Linux. It's still running OpenStack. It's probably still running KVM. But then you have a sort of more specialized projects, such as the OpenFastpath, which just recently demonstrated having like an optimized IPsec tunnel for the 5G user plane. And the hardware also looks different. The hardware can be on the cell tower, somewhere hard to reach location. It could be in an office corner somewhere, in a cabinet, sort of anywhere. So it's more like embedded. It has to generate as little heat as possible. And it looks pretty different. So one thing that I sort of simplified a little bit here is that I say that the core network is in the data center and the radio network is in the edge cloud. It's more complicated than that. And this is a nice picture to show that you can also have the radio controllers, the radio part running in the big data center, or on the other hand, you can have everything running in a edge cloud, in a backpack, something like that. What does it mean for OpenStack? It means, first of all, you have this edge clouds. They can be very small, especially if you think like mobile edge computing or something like that. So you have to scale down OpenStack as much as possible, and still, because the locations are so different, you don't want to climb up the cell tower every time there's a hardware failure, or at least you don't want to lose the service if there's a hardware failure. So you have to
you still have to sort of to do the deployment so that you have this high availability feature. So everything has to be replicated. So the minimum that you have is two servers, and then you have they have both the controllers and the compute units, and all of the OpenStack services have to be sort of replicated on these two servers. A natural requirement is the real time. So obviously we have to meet this 1 millisecond latency requirement. And if we want to meet this kind of provide very high throughput, very low latencies, what we have to do is we have to optimize the whole stack. So we need to have this virtual switches optimized. But then also we have to go to the hardware level. So there was a nice Twitter post this morning that if you want to optimize the whole stack, the full stack, you also have to consider the hardware. So that's something that plays a role in this picture. And then obviously, like I said, you don't want to climb up, or like Juha said, you don't want to climb up to the cell tower every time you need to upgrade the OpenStack software. So this management has to be very, very simple and very automated. And the number of these edge clouds can be in the hundreds, or it could be even in the thousands in certain cases, depending on how the deployment is actually going to go. So now I'm going to talk about a little bit like this hardware optimization and sort of integrating the OpenStack to the hardware. And this is the typical deployment. You have the virtual machine running. You have a NIC, a virtual NIC connected to the virtual machine. And then there's this virtual switch with the slow path. And of course, everything in this picture is slow path. The definition of slow path is things which are done in software. And then you have the physical NIC in the bottom. And now, what one optimization is this smart NICs or intelligent NICs, where you're actually offloading some of the packet processing that is normally done in the virtual switch, you're offloading that to the NIC. So when the packet comes in, it actually, if it goes to the fast path, it can go directly out through the virtual switch without having to go to this use the software side at all. Or you can also go so that you do the switching of the packet inside of the virtual switch, and then you just DMA it directly to the virtual machine memory, which is of course much faster than having to go to do the switching in the virtual switch. And then another sort of optimization is adding the accelerators, and I have some examples of the accelerators. IPsec is a very natural one. Random number generation is very important for the sort of security applications, and that's actually can be a very heavy operation, but it's easy to do it. If you do it in software, it can be time-consuming and heavy, but if you can have very optimized hardware-based random number generations. Then interesting area is having an FPGA programmable NIC or programmable code in the hardware side, so that the application, which knows what it can do, what it wants to be done, it can offload the FPGA code to the accelerator. And then finally, especially in these radio applications, we can have optimizations, accelerators for the air interface. And with the air interface standards, what comes to mind is BDCD, Polar, and Turbo encoder. Did I say it correctly?
More or less, yes.
Okay, thank you. I'm not the radio guy, as you noticed. Okay, so about this accelerator, if you just make it available through the PCI interface, then of course what you have is that you have the hardware visible to the virtual machine. So what would really be nice to do, would be the right way to do it, is to have like acceleration API, and then the applications that you build would use the accelerator interface or accelerator API in the code, and then it could either use the PCI device that you make available, or it could use software accelerator in the case where you don't have the hardware available. So this is the right way of doing it, and this is actually a topic I'm very interested in, and some we should probably start a project about this at some point. So, what does it have to do with OpenStack? All right. So, how is the OpenStack actually involved in this area? So, one area is obviously that if you want to sort of take away some of the functionality from the virtual switch and offload it to a hardware switch, that has some changes, may have some changes to the OpenStack. And then another area is that if you're doing it with SROV, that you make this NIC visible to the virtual machine through SROV, then of course this OpenStack has to be able to sort of configure the virtual machine so that it knows that it has this kind of interface visible to it. And then obviously on the right hand side you are using something like SROV if you're making the PCI device available to the virtual machine. So that's the OpenStack side here. I talked about this management maintenance area. This is the best picture I found from the Etsy NFV specifications about the management, especially about like the how do you do software upgrades of the hosts and so forth. So it looks pretty complicated picture, but basically what it has is that on the bottom side you have this host management, infrastructure management, where you are sort of configuring the physical machines and talk about like the host functionalities. And then on the top side, you have the sort of the application managers, which are talking to the virtualized network functions and the applications. And what makes this management or maintenance complicated is that you have to sort of need to synchronize both sides. So if you want to do maintenance, you have to move the VNF functionality to the other side. And then only after that you are able to do the host management, because you don't want to break any connections or disturb the traffic in any way. So, and then one very interesting area also to sort of speed up things is that we can have more performance by delayering. So if you have this architecture where you have running a cloud infrastructure, you have hypervisors, and then you're running containers on top of the virtual machines, then of course that doesn't make that much sense. You get, in the case of running containers, you can leave out the hypervisor, you can leave out the virtual machines, and then you can actually, of course, share the container infra and the container infra management between the two virtual machines. So how this is going to be done, I think that's something that everybody here is interested in sort of moving from the virtual machines to the containers. And the way we see it is that in the future there's going to be a choice between sort of running VNFs either in a virtual machine or in a container, and then it's up to the sort of the operator which way they want to run their cloud. Some of them may want to run it in a virtual machine, some may want to move to the containers directly. So this was the picture about that. All right, so to summarize, for scaling down, we can have the hardware acceleration. So one benefit of hardware optimizations I didn't mention is that you can actually, if you're offloading functionalities to hardware, you can save CPU cores, you can save hardware, and you can that way you can make by making your hardware more powerful or more optimized to the use case, you can reduce the amount of hardware that you need. And then we also need to make sure that OpenStack is able to scale down to small deployments. And of course, here again, I think the containers could be one part of the solution in running the OpenStack services in containers. For real time, I mentioned the smart NICs. And I mentioned that the hardware acceleration. One thing I didn't mention, but that is part of the picture, is the real-time Linux, real-time KVM optimizations for the virtual switches, for example. And then in management, one very interesting project that is working in this area is the OpenFE Doctor project. And then there's also this self-healing special interest group, which is meeting tomorrow morning, that is going to be discussing about sort of managing, how to manage the whole stack of, from the application to the host software down. All right, so Juha, is OpenStack going to be everywhere in the 5G networks? What is your summary from this presentation?
Thanks, Tapio. That's an easy question. But if we check the main points from our presentation, so like I said, the 5G standards will be ready in 2018. And most of the 5G networks will run on clouds. And if somebody is thinking about to move to the cloud, I would say that it is time to move to the cloud now. Don't wait for this 5G. Do it now. And then this 5G will bring new challenges to OpenStack. And if these challenges can be solved, then I would say that OpenStack can be everywhere in 5G.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. That was our presentation.